due parole di introdurre il relatore di quest'ultima lezione di questo corso di dottorato su argomenti associati in ambito interno della società in senso ampio. È il professor Marco Alberini, un collega portoghese di Berlino fino a poco anni fa, adesso docente di Milano. Con il professor Calderini abbiamo fatto molte cose insieme a partire dal 2003-2004 proprio in ambito di istituzione società, quindi all'epoca si occupava prevalentemente di società intellettuale e finanza, però i suoi interessi sono più ampi, per cui sono ovviamente due sempre a partire dal 2004 e quindi mi è molto piacere che ospitiamo ancora oggi. Anche un grande centromezza sull'intera società che sta qua sopra, quindi un altro motivo di contatto e di collaborazione. E da qualche anno, direi, si occupa di un tema che è progressivamente diventato di grande rilevanza a livello internazionale, nelle istituzioni internazionali, e forse ci dirà qualcosa anche su questo, cioè l'innovazione sociale. L'innovazione sociale è un termine che non nasce sicuramente 5 anni fa, ma storia molto più antica. Ma l'accezione di innovazione sociale in questi ultimi anni ha cominciato a assumere una nuova accezione di quello che ci parlerà oggi in questo caso. Ok, detto questo, non so se avrà altro tempo, anche perché so che poi non ricevere il punto della pandemia, per cui lo ringrazio di essere venuto e passiamo a parlare.
Okay, thank you very much, Juan Carlos, for the introduction, and thank you very much for the invitation. I appreciate it. I'm very honored to be next up trustee. Next has been one of my inspirational premises in my recent career, and I think many of the themes are strictly connected. As Juan Carlos was saying, I was saying just one very little biographical note, because it matters and it has a relevance to the things that I'm going to tell you. The biographical note is exactly that I've been a professor at Politecnico di Torino until 2013. My career was in management of innovation. But one day, the director of Politecnico di Milano called me, and he had a proposal for me. The proposal was based on one intuition, that is basically the intuition that is at the center of my presentation. The intuition is social innovation, more than social innovation, social entrepreneurship is changing, and in this process of change, technology matters. Actually, technology is the main driver for in this process of change in innovation. And so the intuition was a school of management in one of the most prestigious universities, technical universities in Italy, has to have a competence center in, let's say, a new generation of social innovation and entrepreneurship. This is the first biographical note. The second biographical note, and then we are done with that. The second biographical note is that in my interest and passion in social innovation started to emerge when I was invited, well, actually I was sent by the Italian government, I was the advisor to the Minister of Research and Innovation at the time. They sent me to London, to the city of London, the headquarters of Bloomberg, so one place that is not actually social innovation, it's not actually third sector, it is business as usual and in the strongest form. So, in the premises of Bloomberg, and we were invited, and the welcome was from the former Prime Minister of England, of the United Kingdom, David Cameron. And David Cameron, on that day, invited in Bloomberg, in the premises of Bloomberg, the big names of international finance, the real ones, the sharks, right? The tough one, not social, exactly the contrary of social. And And the words he addressed to these people were basically, cutting a very long story short, welfare policies are withdrawing all over the world, all over the industrialized world. Welfare policies are withdrawing. My dear friend from the financial markets, this is a huge opportunity for you. So that was very tough, very direct. And of course, very controversial in ideological terms. But that puts on the table the second ingredient of the story. The first one is social entrepreneurship is changing, and technology is a driver of change, a very important driver of change. The second is welfare policies are no longer there to take care of all the emerging societal needs and societal challenges, and for someone, the solution is a new model of engagement, a new engagement rule between the private system and the public system. So, if you want, ideologically, this story, we must be very honest in that, this story started with, in the ideological crave of Margaret Thatcher in the early 70s, for two reasons. First, because the withdrawal of public policies, welfare policies, started in the early 70s with Margaret Thatcher. Second, because the solution that Margaret Thatcher proposed was the state is no longer able to take care of all the emerging societal needs, the civil society has to step in and take care of this. With all the ideological problems that, of course, follow. Now, the fact that we need to honestly recognize where this story ideologically belongs, we also have to say that it's not given that this story has to go back to this ideological coating. Right? So, I think my position, at the end of the story, my position is that the ideological content of this story can be something very different from the typical neoliberal approach, right? So, let's put it like this. This story is highly at risk of being very, very neoliberalist. Neoliberalist means withdrawal of the state, the market tries to accommodate the different needs of the citizens. There are other options that we need to explore, of course. One final introductory remark is that today, since I understand you are all Italian citizens, yeah? So today is a very, very special day for giving this lecture. I don't know if Nexa was so able to foresee the future to fix the date of this lecture today, but yesterday, in the late afternoon, the Italian government, the Consumer Ministry, finally approved in its final form the reform of the third sector. Right? So that defines a new concept of social enterprise. Right? When you think of social entrepreneurship or social innovation in Italy, your mind goes directly to the cooperative forms, goes to the voluntary activities, it goes to onlus associations, these kind of things, right? This reform is the final step of the Italian legal system to accommodate in the Italian system a new form of enterprise, social enterprise, that is very different from the tradition of the third sector, non-profit sector, as we used to know it, for a number of reasons. There are good news in this bill of law. One is it's recognized that the social enterprise, any initiative in social innovation, can be hybrid, meaning that can pursue social objectives and economic sustainability objectives, or even profit, right? And defines new forms of governance that are equally important because, for example, it is recognized that in cooperative forms, in the new impresa sociale that will come, in the board of directors, you can accommodate private investors. Right? Again, financial people. Right. This is only the last act of an important process of transformation by which the governments of every country in the world try to accommodate the civil law, the legal system, to take into account this very rapid evolution of the forms of social entrepreneurship. If you look at the Italian system story, you have in 2012, you have the so-called startup of operazione sociale. Startup of operazione sociale is a specific thing that came into the Italian system following this idea. We have high-tech startups, but we observe the emergence of high-tech startups that are there also to pursue positive social impact. Okay? An example, an easy example, I don't know if you ever run into Mario's Way. Mario's Way is this Italian company, Italian high-tech startup, that is designing the vertical wheelchair, something that looks like a sort of segue for disabled, sorting out many problems, among which the psychological problem of talking to other people from a sitting position to someone that is actually standing. Now, if you look at this company, if you look at it from one side, it is actually a high-tech startup. If you look from the other side, it is actually a social enterprise. Right? Why is that? Because it goes for a specific profit objective, but also intentionally pursues a social impact. I stress the word intentionally because we need to face one big turning point in our line of argument. This turning point is the problem of social impact. Because if in this room we'll be sitting a typical orthodox neoclassical economist, would immediately raise his hand and say, Professor Cardellini is just telling you crap. Right? This is bullshit, nonsense. Why is that? This is because, as we all know, every well-managed company has a positive social impact. Right? So you're calling, you're naming social enterprise or social innovation or social impact something that has ever existed in the market and is a well-managed company. Because a well-managed company is creating wealth, is creating jobs, is creating employment, all this stuff. So what's this nonsense about? The answer is in the word I stress, that is intentionally. Because the problem is intentionally exempting creating social impact, a measurable social impact. Otherwise, I agree, every well-managed company is a positive social impact company. So the typical example where you have this huge fight between evolutionary economists against classical economists is the story of Ryanair, right? So the argument is that Ryanair opened up a new route to Trapani, and Trapani, after a long era of decadence, had a new renaissance. Restaurants, tourist attractions, social enterprise, a lot of initiatives. So, the neoclassical economists would argue, so you're telling me that Ryanair is a social innovation company, a social enterprise, or social impact-oriented company. The answer must be, not at all, because intentionality is the keyword. A social enterprise is something that can name a social enterprise or a social innovation-oriented company if intentionally pursues a positive social impact that is ex post measurable, right? So intentionality makes a difference. This is your argument against neoclassical economists. So I want to tell you this story. Before going on in the more structured way, I would like to tell you the story as it is, in a very simple way. Right? The story is this. The story I'm going to tell you today. Shorts. Shall I just sit in?
Searching. It's on the table.
So, the story is this. I will try to demonstrate and to tell you that there is a new economic entity, some author, some scholar would say, a new entrepreneurial genre that is emerging that we will call a social venture. Right? So, this is the thesis. There is a new entrepreneurial genre that is social venture. And in my presentation, you will see there is now rather abundant literature that demonstrates that this economic entity exists. So the big questions today are, what is it? Where does it come from? Why? What are the forces that are determining the emergence of this entrepreneurial genre? And what are the managerial challenges? So this is the first managerial part. Second, and this is the tough part, more policy-oriented, is why I believe, many authors and scholars believe, but most importantly, the Commissioner for Research and Innovation, Moenes, thinks that this object is the center of the new industrial policy of Europe. Right? So, what is happening, and this is an important thing to observe, is that in the European Commission, the Commissioner for Research, Science, Research and Innovation, Moedas, decided one day to take social innovation out of the welfare policies, so away from the Commissioner for Labour and Welfare and social policies, and into his competencies, namely research and innovation. Why is that? First, because he shares with me, director of Polytechnic Milan, and many other more important people, the idea that technology matters in this story. Technology is the turning point, first. Second, that social innovation, or if you want, social tech, is the new option for a new industrial policy in Europe. And I think that the interesting conclusion for you is also that I do think that, as I tried to demonstrate, I would think that it is also a very important option for a new generation of technology transfer policies. My strong view is that technology transfer, as we knew it, namely university-centered, research-centered, technology-originated, is dead, and there is a new generation that has to be managed and set up, that is social tech-driven. And in this story, one last thing, why this title of this presentation? The title is the same of the presentation I used in the hearings of Commissioner Moedas. It's a social innovation oxymoron, older and emergent. Because now social innovation is in its full height, right? This is a very fashionable keyword, okay? So it's perceived as a very new thing, but at the same time, it is a very, very old thing. So the oxymoron is that It is both emergent and old. And what makes it emergent? And what can tell you that we are not taking care or you're not dealing with a very old and dusty story? Something that we have been already discussing 30 years ago. Technology. Technology has changed and is changing the rule of the games. Now, so what is the story? The story is we have this social venture and we have the intuition that this is a new big player in the entrepreneurial world. This is good news. Bad news is that we don't know what it is. Right? We are not able to identify it exactly. There are two things that the literature is able to say about the three things about the characteristics of this new emerging archetype of entrepreneurial model. That is, first, that is going to be hybrid. Second, that is going to be technology or knowledge intensive. Right? So we know that there is a new player in the field emerging, a new entrepreneurial gender, where we recognize two specific characteristics. First, it is hybrid. Hybrid means its objective function is not profit or the maximization of value for the shareholders, but is both economic or financial return and measurable social impact. So it's hybrid because it tries to do two things. This concept of hybridity is very important to grasp at the very beginning of the lecture. And the other way to say that is blended value. It's not economic value, it's blended value, meaning social and economic together. Now, there is one example I want to propose to you because it's useful to understand what I mean by hybridity, real hybridity, and also because it confronts you with the moral problem and ideological problem that is associated with this entity. What is the story? The story, and it is not by chance the example with which I start my course in Milan. The example is this. There is a German company that is called Spezialiserne. Right? Spezialiserne is a German company that recruits young people suffering from a very severe form of autism. So, autistic guys. Severe forms. Guys that have big troubles. Okay? They recruit them, so this is their labor force, and they hire these people to big companies, Google, Amazon, Accenture, Finmeccanica, whatever, in order to perform repetitive tasks that require a huge degree of attention for a long, long time during the day. So, for example, checking software code lines or checking small parts in manufacturing processes. Okay? They employ these people, they get them to perform this task that they perform very well given their illness, and they make not a huge amount of money out of that, but they are certainly economically sustainable company, as many other profit companies. Now, this example gives you two hints. First, this is hybridity, because they have a clear social impact objective, that is, include these people in the labor market, so offering the opportunity to these people to have a regular job somehow. On the other side, they make money, so they go for an economic or financial objective. Now, so, the example is a clear example of hybridity. Then, it is a useful example because it puts you in front of the moral, the different moral perspectives from which you can look at this phenomenon. So you can be enthusiastic, being an enthusiastic admirer of this model, or you can find it disgusting. Because alternatively, you can think this is a very nice thing. They don't ask for public money. They are a sustainable, economically sustainable activity, and they have clear social impact of including these people. This is the positive perspective. The negative perspective is they are just exploiting these people that live with a very bad problem. Right? I won't do this because the numbers are too little. When I have a big class, I ask what is the prevailing perspective of each student, and I have usually a 50-50 result of the poll. Okay? So, hybridity and technology intensity. Let me give you another example for technology intensity, because it gives you the idea of how much and how strong is the ongoing change. So take a typical social innovation company, social enterprise. Social enterprise is, this is a real life example, or it's a mid-sized village or city in England. And this there is a social enterprise with a very traditional model. They hire college students, they give them maybe £20, and they ask them every day or every two days to knock the doors of that many people in the village and ask if everything is all right, bring them food, medicines, whatever. So to assist this guy in check is a model of assistance, right? And of course the model is labor intensive. There is no capital, no technology there. There is just these guys knocking the doors and assisting the elderly people. This company one day understood that the price of the sensors was going down and down and down. So a sensor, a very simple sensor, can be bought for, let's say, 30 cents. Okay? So technology is actually a commodity, and here comes the important point. There is a frontier of opportunity of technologies that are very cheap and enable new models of social intervention. So they say the sensor are very, very cheap, so why don't we distribute sensors all over the place in the house of the elderly people? These sensors are wireless connected to a computer somewhere with an algorithm that is able to identify the patterns of movement of these elderly people in their houses. So for example, if they are laying in bed too long, if they are not moving, if they are not at home, they did not come back home, if the pattern of movement in the house is regular, is sort of continuous pattern over the day, so it's changing, they are getting more and more tired, all this stuff. And what happens to this, again, you can think it's nice or not nice. The point is, what is happening is that now they do not hire maybe 100 college students, they hire just 5 college students that they send to see the elderly people when there is a need for it. All the rest is performed through technology and capital. Now, you may think, and you may be right, that the elderly old lady living in the bush was happier to have the students knocking the door and taking care of her instead of the computer, remote computer, identifier of pattern of movement. This is another story. The important story is that there is transformation in the model of intervention of social enterprise from labor intensive to capital intensive. And when it comes to capital intensive, the capital in social enterprise brings in a huge number of different problems. First, you need to look for capital, but then you're not a very profitable company. So looking for capital, traditional capital, is not easy. And so you need to go for specialized finance. And this is why there is a supply of specialized finance that is hybrid, as much as hybrid as the company that has to be financed. And then if it is capital, you need competencies that were not traditionally in the non-profit sector. You need managerial capabilities, you need entrepreneurial saturation, It's a whole new world that opens up. So, there is this thing. And we know two characteristics, hybrid and technology intensive. And we have been able to observe that this new entity is being generated through two different paths of transformation. One comes from non-profit, or third sector, and there is a path that is making the social enterprise, so onlus, cooperative, associazioni, old imprese sociali, all this stuff, that is becoming more structured, more entrepreneurial, more managerial, more able to manage technology, to use and manage technology, and is transforming into the social venture. Okay? And this is one pattern of evolution. But also, there is a second pattern of evolution, that is this thing here. That is the traditional profit center that is hybridizing itself, is transforming itself, is adapting itself to the needs of the social venture. Okay? So, these, we know three things. That there is an emerging object, that is a social venture with two clear characteristics, hybridity and tech intensity, first. Second, that is the product, the convergence of two evolutionary processes. One, the non-profit becoming more structured. Second, the profit sector, that is, adapting itself to become more socially oriented. And this transformation is the transformation of corporate social responsibility. Because as you might know, every company, profit company, also the companies producing weapons and drugs and doing very bad things, have always had a corporate social responsibility function, right? So, if you go in Africa and you destroy the local environment, then you build the school and the wells in order to compensate for the damage. So this is the old corporate social innovation, the corporate social responsibility. Now, there is the transformation here of the profit company can be described as a transformation that takes corporate social responsibility and integrates it into the core business of the company. So the two things are not detached. The corporate social responsibility office is not the last office at the bottom of the corridor. The new generation, someone calls it corporate social responsibility 2.0, advanced corporate social responsibility, is I am corporate socially responsible while I perform my core business. So, Amy, for example, instead of building the school and the wells, probably invest equity money in local social enterprises with the explicit purpose to make it grow and include them in their supply chain. First, at the very bottom level, for example, to cook food for any employees, and then more and more, higher and higher in the supply chain, getting them to become suppliers. What is the there is a social impact, but also an economic impact, because having a social supply chain, a local supply chain, probably actually empirically demonstrated it has lowered the unit production cost of anything. Okay? So, two examples. Transformation of profit and evolution of profit. There is one final introductory thing that we need to say, and then we go back to some literature. What we need to say is this thing. Here. When you see a new economic entity emerging, like this social venture, You need, and you see transformation processes going on. What you have to ask yourself is, why is that happening? This is a typical question of economics. Why is it happening? What is generating this change? And this is, well, this is a long story, but this is the thing. So social venture and all this process of transformation is generated, triggered by, in my view, four drivers that are putting a lot of pressures on old model of old entrepreneurship and are generating this transformation. So let's start from the easiest one. Societal challenges. What we mean by societal challenges. Societal challenges are urbanization, migrations, poverty, drought, climate change, education exclusion, financial exclusion, all the challenges we can. Your objection here would be, well, we come from a world that has always lived with huge societal challenges. True. The news is that these societal challenges are now right in the middle of our cities, are right in the middle of countries. So this story, the story of non-profit, is a story that your mind usually immediately locates in developing countries. Big news is that education exclusion, poverty, migration, climate change are hitting hard our countries, the countries that we call developed countries. Right? So this is the problem. Second easy thing, because we have already mentioned, welfare withdrawal. You may like it or not, welfare policies are withdrawing. And this is a tricky argument, of course, because if it becomes political, we need to be very careful to handle this argument. Because there is one attitude towards this problem, and that is, welfare policies are withdrawing, we take it for granted, and so we need to find alternative solutions. This is one way at the crossroad. The other is, I do not accept, and it is absolutely legitimate and right, I do not accept that welfare policies are withdrawn. And so, instead of finding alternative solutions, I will fight for public policy to stay there and not to withdraw. Okay? Politically or ideologically, it's absolutely, this is a crossroad. My view is somewhere in the middle. I think that there is no way that, given the state of public finance, we can think that welfare policies are taking care of all societal challenges. So the way that we need to, the attitude that we need to use is somehow in circular, concentric circles. That is, public-private alternative solutions are useful when to be used for social problems that are not very sensitive in political or ideological terms. And they must be used at the border of societal challenges for external things, exactly in order to free public resources and be able to use them in these sectors or for these problems where, my conviction is, public intervention should be pure public intervention. So, if this is my idea here, because I don't want to dodge this problem. My idea is, this is the spectrum, if you want, of social needs that are emerging and that social policies should tackle. I think that there is no way that public policy in the future will be able to cover all these needs. So we need to isolate two subsets of needs. One external one, where I think it is very useful to use social enterprise, civil society, private, public-private partnership to solve problems, exactly because this is the way to have public resources in the inner circle where I locate health and education, just to give you two examples, where public intervention should be, if not total, at least the vast majority of the money that is used. Okay, this is my solution at that crossroads. But of course, this is another long story. There are two other things that are more specific to the lecture. The first thing is technological opportunities. So what I told you is technological opportunities are there, and it, not always we're talking about high-tech solutions. Probably we are talking low to medium tech. They are becoming commodities for the same reason that are easy to use, so there is an interface problem that becomes interesting, and then they are cheap. So, what do I mean? What is the role of technology in this story? First, technology enables new models of social intervention, so new solutions. The example of the elderly people care is one example. The example of the use, for example, of open hardware platforms to personalize devices for disabled people is another beautiful example. Open data application where someone that is on a wheelchair, someone that is on a wheelchair can see when it can travel and which services can enjoy when it travels. Another important problem, the app that is connecting migrants or the refugees with their local community is another example. But think of sharing economy, the food sharing economy. Food sharing has been a model of a business model that has always existed, right? In small villages in Italy, from maybe 200 years, if the bakery has exceeding bread, has too much bread that is not going to sell at night, the poor people go there and take this bread. So it's not a wonderful innovation or intuition. The problem is that when you have an IT platform that can help you to scale up and to match demand and supply on a metropolitan scale, of course, the business model is not only more effective, more social impact, but it becomes a sort of market for social enterprises that want to engage in this model. For example, there is this Boston social enterprise that is that has set up this IT platform, puts together restaurants with too much unused food, and then communities of poor people, or other organizations that take care of poverty, they connect this thing, they collect the unused food, then they hire women that were victims of domestic violence, they get them to cook this food, and then they run small restaurants for a very low price, so that are inclusive, where people go and eat the food that is cooked by these women, and it is using raw material that is unused by restaurants. So, you see how many social impact dimensions you can put together. You don't waste food. You minimize waste. You include and give a chance of freedom to women that are victims of domestic violence. You run this restaurant and you help, for example, homeless people to go and eat decent food. And in a way, it is economically sustainable. Of course, you cannot expect a huge amount of money out of this business, but it's more or less economically sustainable. This is hybridity in one way. But this is enabled by an IT platform. Otherwise, if you don't have something that matches on a large scale demand and supply, this business model would be feasible. Okay? But it's not only this. Technology is also crucial because it allows you to identify new social problems. Think of two very simple applications. Lottomatica. managing slot machines in the tabacchetti. Right? You know that tabacchetti are a place where gamble addiction is very severe. Right? These slot machines, as you know, are connected, again, have a distance connection, wireless connection, computer, somewhere where the data are stored. You can use an algorithm, once again, to identify distorted patterns of use of this machine. You may know that in this tobacconist, in this very poor area of the city, there is someone between 3 and 3:30 that goes every single day and loses a huge amount of money. Right? And so you can send, and you will never declare this addiction, you can send some social enterprise there and ask them to take care of this guy and his addiction. This is enabled by big data application. Or, again, big data comes in when you have people that are very, you have energy bills, or water bills, or gas bills, whatever bill you can have. You use big data, very simple algorithm, somehow in engineering terms, and you use this algorithm to identify people that are later and later in paying the bills, or are not actually paying the bills at all. So you can identify areas of emerging poverty in a metropolitan area, or single people with a problem that they would never declare for a reason of pride. So once again, technology, hardware and software is able to identify new social problems and so to enable new solutions. Okay? And finally, the other big thing is that technological opportunities have created new economic paradigms. What economists mean by new economic paradigms? New transactional schemes, new ways for parties to exchange goods and services. Right? So the three examples is the sharing economy, the circular economy, and the inclusive economy. These are new markets paradigms, new markets if you want, that are new opportunities for this kind of enterprise, a new economic entity. Because if you want to be a hybrid entrepreneurial entity, you need to have a market in which to exert your hybridity. And the market has to be hybrid itself. If there is no market, there is no chance for the company to be hybrid and profitable. Okay? So, I think that there is no need for me to explain you what the sharing economy is. We're not talking about the sharing economy models that have dramatically drifted away from the original model, like Uber or Airbnb, that have become global monopolies based on very hierarchical structures, so that have never nothing to do with the original sharing economy pattern, but I'm talking about genuine sharing economy application, like food sharing application and cities. And then you have the circular economy, of course. The circular economy is something that works more or less like that. You have the production chain. Again, I think you know what is it. You have raw material here. You have the product or service here. The traditional production model is linear. You start with raw material, you end up with the product of a service. The intuition of the circular economy is simply to bend this line and to make it circular. That is, you use raw material to produce, waste as a raw material in the production process. Where you have dozens of examples, not only recycling, that is the most simple example, but also the example of the restaurant in Boston is a good example because you use wasted food as raw material for cooking. Or another example is the repair cafe model. Have you ever been in the repair cafe in Amsterdam? That is the original one, where people take their old appliances and you have their volunteer engineers that repair these appliances and resell these appliances, making the model sustainable and reducing the amount of waste that is left to the environment, and of course also includes people that would never be able to afford these appliances in the possibility to buy and use one of those appliances. Once again, a very simple model, nothing strange, but something that is economically sustainable, also profitable somehow, and with different dimensions of social impact. And then the inclusive economy. On the inclusive economy, I would like to spend 1 second more because it's less intuitive than the other things. And the intuition is very simple. This is a frequency distribution. And imagine that on the horizontal axis, we put purchasing power of single individuals. Right? Now, unfortunately, the purchasing power of single individuals in the world, 6 billion people living on Earth, is more or less like this, very skewed. Okay? So the idea, you have a lot of figures about that, but the idea is that more or less 3 billion people in the world live with less than $100 per week, per month, and then there is a small fraction of the world that owns all the wealth that is owned by the rest of the world. So the top 0.5% in the world is rich enough to be richer than the rest of the world. Now, the traditional business model, the business model of whatever Western company, is more or less targeting this stuff here. Okay? And this stuff here, why is that? Because here you have, of course, lower volumes, right? Because there are less people here in this distribution than here, but you have higher margins because these people, you can charge higher price to these people. Okay? This part of the world has never considered, has never been considered a market. And we call this bottom of the pyramid market, BOP. Okay? Now, the intuition of someone, actually the intuition that was brought forward by the Nobel Prize Union, Muhammad Yunus, was that there is an alternative business model, not high margins multiplied low volumes, but high volumes multiplied low margins. Right? And this is the inclusive economy. What does it mean? Take LeapFrog, then if you Google, you can find a lot of information about this. So LeapFrog Insurance is a social impact insurance company that observes this problem. Location setting in Rwanda. Families living more or less with $1 a day. And the dollar is earned by the head of family, of very numerous families. Okay? What happens is that, of course, Rwanda has a high mortality rate. What happens when the head of the family dies for some reason, the family is left completely without protection. No life insurance, nothing. So LeapFrog decided to collect philanthropic money, or semi-philanthropic money, and try to develop a financial insurance product that was able to include this population in the insurance market, meaning to offer protection to people that in traditional markets would have never been able to afford this protection. So they developed one life insurance that costs roughly $1 per month. So one day of a family, and provides a very, very basic life insurance or life protection insurance. Right? This is inclusive economy because it brings in people that would otherwise be excluded. The Khan Academy in the education field is a typical example of inclusive economy. Okay? Right. So we have bottom of the pyramid. Now, since you are, I guess, mainly or total engineers? Everybody?
No.
No?
Design.
Design.
Architect.
Architect. So this will sound familiar to you. This is a huge challenge for engineering and design altogether. Why is that? Because when you go, you leverage on technological opportunities to go to try to exploit through a real business model, bottom of the pyramid countries, you need to change the way you innovate. And I had a beautiful picture, but I didn't include it in the presentation because I think it takes too much time. But imagine this situation. The problem is the same. We have a 30 years old rich Californian guy who lost his arm, right? And a very poor Bangladesh young children, 11 years old, who lost his arms because he stepped on a mine. There is his leg, because he stepped on a mine. The innovation challenge here is radically different. The Californian guy will, and the market that is served, that is there for the California guy, will go probably for a so-called super functional arm. So an arm that will allow this guy to perform a very complex operation. The most complex operation, I was told, is to drink from a bottle, right? So an artificial arm that is able to perform this operation is a very sophisticated arm. And so it's the dream of every engineer, right? You have the engineer there trying to sophisticate his arm as much as possible. Of course, it costs a lot. It is very difficult to install. It is very difficult to maintain. So it's absolutely appropriate for the Californian guy, but it's not appropriate for the Bangladesh guy. Not only because it's too expensive, but because this guy lives in Bangladesh, and is growing up. So we need something that is very cheap, that is modular and simple, so that you can adapt to the different age of the guy, and easy to install, because probably there you don't have physicians to take care of the installation or the maintenance of your. Now the point that I want to stress is that these are two equally interesting and prestigious engineering challenges. And when you try to set up your business model in order to be able to exploit or to perform your business model in the so-called inclusive economy or bottom of the pyramid market, you need to completely change your mindset, innovation mindset. You need to leave alone any sophistication, any super functional aspiration, and you need to make your creativity work for an equally important objective, that is, develop something that is suitable to that challenge. Okay? And this is not easy, not always easy for engineers. So, let's try to wrap up the story. The story is, there is a social venture that is created by these processes. These processes are generated by the pressure that is exerted by these four big drivers: new emerging societal challenges, welfare policy withdrawal, technological opportunities or technological monetization, and new forms of markets that are there to accommodate the business model that we have just described. Okay? This is the story. It is obvious that, is there any management engineer here? Just an idea? No. Right. In terms of management, this story, so I'll be very short on it. This story poses very important problems, because this transformation When I say that the company is becoming managerial, entrepreneurial, competence intensive, engineering intensive, technology intensive, whatever, requires managerial ability. And the important thing is that these managerial abilities are not managerial abilities or techniques that you find on the shelf. You don't go to visit Bocconi. I take every occasion to the ruler of Bocconi. You don't go to Bocconi and take general purpose management techniques and apply and then explain to the social enterprise. This is very specific. And the change is very deep. Just one example. If it is technology intensive, imagine that you are a social innovation company that is trying to be in the inclusive economy market model. Fair enough. But imagine that you have intellectual property in the technology that you use to solve the innovation problem. Intellectual property is an exclusive right, or a right to exclude, right? The word exclude in social innovation doesn't fit. There is a huge contradiction. And what's behind this contradiction? The orthogonality of the objectives. For example, in traditional social innovation, the non-hybrid one, the totally non-profit one, I have a beautiful business model, social model, to take care of women that are victims of domestic violence. It works. I want to scale up. Easy. Traditionally, what you do, you call your friend in Treviso and your other friend in Palermo, you visit them, and not only you tell them how the model works, but you help them to replicate it. As easy as that. Now imagine that you are a hybrid organization, a social venture, that is using technology, and since it's using technology, it requires capital. And since it requires capital, it needs investors. Right? And the investor wants it to be in the board of directors. Now you visit your director and the board of directors, and they ask you, what are you going to do tomorrow? And you tell them, well, I have a friend in Palermo, and I want you to replicate this thing, because I think it is very nice that also in Palermo we can help these women. And the board of directors says, what do you say? It's not like that. We are here for profit, and this is our business model. Okay, it has a social impact, but it is a business model. So why? It's a nonsense to give it away for free. If you want, we go to Palermo and we replicate the model. Right? So there is a tension. On one side, you have the social impact objective that will require you to scale it up as much as possible, no matter the economic sustainability. On the other side, you have the financial guys to say, well, I'm happy to be with you. So he's a nice guy. He's not a bad guy. I'm happy to help to solve this problem, but I'm here because you told me that it is an economically sustainable activity. So, I'm sorry, we don't give it away for free. In management terms, this creates a lot of problems. One example of why this is very difficult to manage. The example is, think in terms of accounting. Right? If you are a hybrid company, and so you have to deliver two objectives, right? Two results, the economic objective has behind an accounting system that is very sound, well established, 200 years old, so you are perfectly able to measure the economic performance. Strong. Measuring social impact is more difficult. There is no established standard. No one has a clue on how to do that. So it's a weak measure. Now you should know, you know probably, that in each organization, when you have a strong metric and a weak metric, the organization is drifting toward the strong metric. As easy as that. And so, of course, this is a huge management and governance problem. Right? Well, so this is the story. So, for example, here, this is exactly the same thing that I've been showing. I've listed, for example, a few of the managerial challenges that are involved in this story. So scale, being able to scale up for social enterprise, to manage technology, to look for impact finance, so specialized finance that is somehow respecting your hybrid nature, because if you take in the board people that only want financial returns, there is no way you can accommodate social impact, you're lost. The measurement of impact, that is a huge area of development, multi-stakeholder governance and other technical things. So here you have all the things that I've already told you. Now I want to connect this thing, if it is clear, then of course you're welcome to ask whatever you feel or to complain or whatever. There are two things that I want to tell you. One is about finance and the other one is about policy and is the conclusion. About finance. We have say, if you have been following or if you believe this story, that we are witnessing a fundamental transformation from labor-intensive models to capital-intensive models of social intervention, right? If this is happening, there is a clear problem of financial resources to assist this problem. Right? When you have social innovation, you're trying to solve a social problem, your main objective has to be to scale it up as much as possible. Scaling up in social innovation means to enlarge as much as possible the number of beneficiaries of your intervention. Right? It is clear. If you can solve the problem of a children that is excluded from the educational process, that is early dropout from the educational process, your desire should be, if you are socially oriented, to help not one, but 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000 children not to be early dropout. So, again, you need capital. And here comes the financial thing, and here this is the closing of the loop with the David Cameron story. So, there are different things that call for specialized finance. Okay? So it's withdrawal of welfare policies, so you need to go for private capital. Technology intensive, so capital intensive solutions. The idea that we need to go for prevention, and prevention is nothing but an anticipation of capital. Right? So, for example, one of the most successful examples of social impact finance for social enterprise is the prevention of type 2 diabetes in Israel. The idea is social finance can anticipate the money to social enterprise that are able to change dietary habits of people, therefore reducing the number of people that will be hospitalized, therefore reducing public money expenditure, and therefore the social impact financing guys that have invested the money in this operation can be repaid by public money on the savings that are produced by the social intervention, right? So this is one other reason. And then, of course, the need for innovative financial solutions to pay for results here, but I will tell you. Supply side, it's not very much interesting for you, but there are many reasons why the financial markets are interested outside the social dimension to promote impact investment. Now, what are we talking about? We are talking about this area here. So, what is the story? The story is that we have these companies that are no longer pure non-profit or mainstream for-profit companies, are something hybrid. In the financial world, usually, we have a dichotomy. Imagine a segment On one extreme of the segment, you have philanthropy grants, so people that is able to give money for social problem and to not to have the money back, so negative returns. On the other side, you have private equity, hedge funds, the financial guys, the real ones. They just go for it. The neoclassical economists have told us that between philanthropy and traditional or mainstream finance, it was no man's land. There was nothing. Instead, between grants and traditional finance, so the finance that you're looking for, maybe 10% financial return, there is a continuum of solutions of blended value. And not by chance, this finance is called three-dimensional finance. Why three-dimensional finance? Because when you go and someone tries to sell you a financial product, what he says to you is usually, well, this product has this return and this risk. So the financial offer is basically measured on a return, risk-return trade-off. Here, in impact finance, I go and see him and I say, if you want to invest in my financial product, I'm offering you three things: risk, return, and measurable social impact. And the relative weight in the portfolio of social impact objectives and financial return objectives gives you all this continuum of solutions. Right? So traditional investing, grants, negative return, market return, a set of financial solutions that can be offered to the social ventures, where I tell you, do you want to invest in my company? My company can demonstrate a measurable social impact. If you invest in my fund that is investing in the company, I offer you not 8% financial return, it is market return, maybe 3%, but alongside a measurable social impact. And you are not a pure philanthropist, so you wouldn't be happy to waste your money, but if I offer you a small financial returns and a measurable social impact, probably you would become happy and able to invest in my hybrid company. So, alongside this process of transformation, what we are witnessing and we will witness in the next future, 2017 is the year of change, because many things and the market is exponentially going up. We will see the emergence of a set of products that are there in this hybrid area between pure philanthropy and pure pure finance. Of course, there are many different, well, this presentation is for you, so if you're curious, you can look at a different instrument, actual instruments that are there. And I want to give you probably the prototypical example of this story, just one of these instruments, but the idea of the instrument is easy. Think of a private equity or a venture capital. Venture capital comes to see the incubator of Politecnico di Torino, looks for startup, high tech startups, and invest money in the startups, trying to ensure probably 15% return to the investors in the venture capital fund. The social impact venture capital, or the social venture capital, is a fund that does exactly the same, but instead of promising 15% return to the investors, says 7% return plus measurable social impact. There is a very popular instrument that is the so-called social impact bond. And I give you this example just to, not, this is one of the many examples I could give, but just to give you a concrete feeling of what we're talking about. So this, the second is the Rikers-Shinhan prison in the New York State. There is the manager of this prison that is desperate because the prison is overcrowded. Not big news for Italy, no, it's overcrowded. And of course, the management becomes impossible, the problems become very severe, and the cost of the management of all these people in the prison is terrible. So he goes to see the public administration and say, I need to build another part of the prison because it's too much for me. And the public administration say, I have no money for you, we cannot do that. The manager tries to say, well, but if you help me, I will be able to treat better my prisoners, and so I can correct what is actually creating overcrowding in my prison, that is re-offense, because 95% of the people that are actually today in my prison are people that were just released. So you release them 2 months and they come back. So he says, if you are able to decrease the rate of re-offense, I can save a lot of money because I don't have so many people in the prison. And so why don't we use these future savings to invest in social innovation models that would reduce the rate of re-offense? And so we, instead of building bigger prisons, we invest in a solution. But the public administration, the governor of the state of New York say, clever idea, I totally agree, but I don't have the money to anticipate to try to prevent this problem. And then this intervention is too risky. So another player, that is Goldman Sachs, comes in. Goldman Sachs is another not typical social innovation player, right? Comes in and says, so I tried this. I develop a social impact bond. I get the citizen to invest in my social impact bond, right? And a social impact bond works like this. If, and then I take this money and I invest in social enterprise that are able to reduce the rate of re-offense. Then I connect the return that I give back to investors to the decrease of the rate of re-offense. So the idea is 1% decrease of rate of re-offense, 0.5 financial interest. 5% decrease of rate of re-offense, 5% interest, and so on. And who pays the interest? The prison, the public administration. Why is that? Because now, if you have designed properly the instrument, you're sure that the money, if the re-offense rate increases, you have savings. So you repay the investor, the initial investors, with the future savings. Very easy. With a lot of problems, we should take maybe one entire morning to discuss this, but this is a typical social impact finance tool that is assisting the new models of social enterprise to do that. Now, closing with policy things. Why do I think that is a very important social policy? My view, having been in the business for the last 25 years, is that the celebrated startup policies, especially university-based startup policies, have been a disaster. Zero, nothing, nil. The political result of the incubators is very little, and actually, the science-based model of startup is clearly, empirically, has not reached full. But it has been successful, of course, Cambridge, Oxford, Silicon Valley, where there is a huge critical mass of science. So where you have a critical mass of science, you squeeze, and you have entrepreneurial development out of that. If you don't have critical mass, so if you don't have enough public investment in the university, you squeeze and nothing comes out. Right? So you need to think something different. There are two things why I think that social tech, so technology at the service of entrepreneurship, is a good option. First, because our incubators, well, not la Politecnico di Torino, in general, are not full of entrepreneurial spirit. There is no hungriness there. Right? There are well-educated 35 years old searching for some glamour on average. So there is not the entrepreneurial spirit, this bitterness that is needed to create an enterprise and make it successful. This is more or less self-employment. Right? I think that if you recruit people from the social innovation with a very strong social vocation, I think that the first important thing is that you bring again entrepreneur, genuine entrepreneurial spirit into incubation and entrepreneurship. That is no longer there. These places, the university, I say it with bitterness, are not creating hungry people, hungry in the Steve Jobs meaning. Okay? So I think that social vocation is able to select in a virtuous way people that are really suitable to the entrepreneurial challenge. First. Second thing, if you go around all these useless ecosystem of incubators, science park, innovation poles, innovation district, all this rubbish, you ask the guys that are there, what they would say to you is, please, do not give me one more euro of finance. This is not the problem. I beg you, give me my first customer. More technically, give me early procurement. Okay, give me a market to scale. And the reason why you are not able to enumerate successful companies in these kind of incubators like this one is that there is a lack of early procurement, early demand. And the thing is that if you bet on the high-tech startup model, you need a high-tech market. But what if the high-tech market is no longer there? What if the technology or research-intensive industries are no longer in this ecosystem? They will never find early procurement. And why social innovation or social entrepreneurship is more effective in this perspective? Because social procurement is still a market in our economy, right? So in re-engineering social procurement in a more technology-intensive and entrepreneurial way will give startups and entrepreneurship as a political option a chance of having some early demand or early procurement that will help this company to scale up. So I think there are at least two good reasons to elect social entrepreneurship as a future model of social entrepreneurship. I think that if you connect the social communities to the startup gamble, you will have a very good result. And this gives you this is what I just said. And this is my final political remark and explains why I strongly recommend and strongly supported the political line that Commissioner Moedas is taking on. It has to do with social accountability of research and technology. So it's a wonderful chance for our academic community as well. In general, there is a need for this community to be socially accountable again, right? So to give back to society in its full value what the society has given us. So the society, the taxpayer, is allowing us with public money to do the best research that we are able to perform, but we need to be accountable to society simply for the reason that we want to be legitimate in asking more money for our research. This is simple. Now the reflection is this, Traditionally, the mechanism of social accountability of research was mediated by industry. So, public research creates a wonderful world of open science. There are ways to transfer the science to the industry. The industry is mediating this knowledge and traditionally has taken care of translating this knowledge into economic value. Right? So, life sciences, big pharma, you may like it or not, medicines, society. Science, innovation, new knowledge, film meccanica, planes, job, value for society, back to society. I'm not saying that is the only value that the university brings back to society. I'm talking about the technology transfer mechanism. Then I recognize there are dozens of incredibly important ways in which the academic community contributes to society. But let's stick to English. Now, the question is simple. What about the areas of Europe, for example, where industry is no longer there and is no longer able to mediate, to intermediate the value of knowledge and transform it into value to society? And then there is this anecdotal, of course there is also nice empirical research, but there is this anecdotal story that when the EU launches social innovation competitions, social innovation prizes, challenges, whatever, there is an incredible over-representation of Greece companies, the Greece initiative, Spanish initiative, Portuguese initiative, Italian initiatives. This is not by chance, right? Because industry is no longer there to employ people or to transform the value of knowledge into societal value. In this channel, strictly referring to this channel. Social innovation and this form of social enterprise that I've described to you, I think, is a wonderful option to find to bypass the problem. So the idea is very simple: knowledge, industry, value to society. Industry is no longer there. We need to find a bypass. I think that social innovation, so an entrepreneurship that is triggered by social problems, is the option of Europe. And it also is an innovation option, right? There is some radical colleague of mine that at this point would step in and say a very strong statement. Too simple to be complete, but very strong, and I think very fascinating. Saying, okay, he would ask me, Mario, name to me two countries in the world where innovation policy has been successful, right? And I would say, well, probably, if I have to be honest, US and Israel, largely due to military procurement, military research. You can wrap up this story and this last remark with a very simple statement. Europe will try to do with civil procurement what US and Israel have been able to do with military procurement. And civil procurement means procurement of innovation to solve societal social problem. So the reflection is to think of tech social innovation, so social innovation that is technology intensive, as a way to convey the value of knowledge directly to society in absence of a consistent industrial option. Right? And my theory is, my statement is, this is a good reason to address specific policies to foster a new generation of tech social ventures. Okay? Thank you very much. I'm here for questions. Questions, complaints, remarks, arguments? You need to think of it. Anyway, you have this presentation, the literature is there, it's more structured, more complete, and you can write to me whenever you want.
Just some
yeah.
Question about measurable impact. how to measure social impact?
Well, this is the question, of course. As usual, two things. A recognition that the problem is terribly difficult, and the other usual statement is that the difficulty is not a good reason to quit. So, there are, today I would say that probably is the hottest area of research in social innovation. And for example, my center is, for my center, impact measurement is a cash cow. So I have a long line of people asking for social measurement. Now it's difficult for many different reasons. For example, I told you the example of the prison. The decrease in reoffense rate is something that is very easy to measure in the short term, and so it's manageable for a financial aid. There was another attempt that was a social intervention to prevent unexpected early pregnancies. The measurement of this stuff is incredibly difficult because, of course, the way it has a social impact intervention is that if you decrease the rate of unexpected early pregnancies, you have a decrease in criminality rate, you have a saving cost for the health system, you have a saving cost for the education system, all this stuff. That are long term. So the long term issue is very difficult. The other very difficult thing is sector specificity. Because, of course, you cannot have an algorithm, a measurement algorithm, that measures the impact of an intervention in the education sector, and it's completely different from intervention in the poverty sector. Right? So it is very important. Actually, now there is rather consolidated literature that tells you how you can measure, and you have very different approaches. For example, you have the SROI, the social return on investment. This is a very specific measure that I hate personally, that puts all the things together and translates into economic value. Well, it's rather sophisticated economics. You have other more sophisticated operations, and most importantly, you have all the counterfactual approaches. So the real approach is everybody is able to measure the outcome. So I educate you, and one day you will learn it. This is the outcome. But the important thing is to able to observe in a separate way what is my contribution, additional contribution, to the fact that you have been graduated, you have graduated. And so I need a control sample. This is why it is counterfactual, where I measure people that have not been exposed to the treatment of social innovation, and there I can isolate the social impact. So, impact measurement is probably a booming area of research, very difficult, not by chance, and this is good news and bad news altogether. All the top consultancy strategy company in the world, McKinsey, Ernst & Young, and whatever, are opening up specific departments of social information.
Thanks. Just a quick question, more on the side. The scheme that you finance activities that will reduce the burden on the public expenditure, how do you see? Do you see any ways to avoid the risk that the pressure to capture all the savings will essentially make it zero?
Well, there is no way to avoid it. One of the other hot issues is in this governance system is the so-called mission lock thing. That is, you need to set up proper governance architectures that make it sort of avoid or prevent drifting of the social mission, and so just leveraging or exploiting the future savings and making its returns for the social government. So it is very difficult, and in this thing, the impact measurement is very important. because the governance architecture are very complex, but the idea is that you always have to have an independent third party. The UK system, for example, is Wellcome Trust, that does that for everyone. So it is an independent trust being that is trusted by the parties, the public system and the private system, to measure the social impact, and it is up to the trust to check that there is an appropriate balance of things. And then the measurement problem is that it is not a technical question. The way one thing is measured changes the nature of the thing. And the measure, the way it's measured, is the result of the bargaining power of the two parties. What is happening now is very, very worrying. When social enterprises come to my center and say, can you measure my value? And I ask, yes, but why? Because my UniCredit asked me to give me money, asking me to measure my value. And I say, yes. And this is not the bad part of the story. The bad part of the story is that a moment after, they take a paper from their bags, and they have a list of value dimension of social impact dimension, that have been defined by the financing body. So there is complete distortion. And so it is up to the regulator, up to the state, to check that the bargaining power is equally balanced by social enterprise and the financing body. There is one additional last comment. Originally, when I go to Compagnia di San Paolo, and I ask, give me money because I want to solve this problem, they give me grants. The risk is totally on Compagnia di San Paolo, on nothing. And it's economically efficient because the risk is taken by a more robust institution. These schemes that I described reallocate risk from the financing body to the social enterprise. Because if I fail, if I do not deliver impact, they do not pay me. And when you bring risk in an organization, the nature and mission of the organization changes radically. And this is another huge political problem associated with this.
Any other question?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you again.